Today we're going to continue our survey of population genetics. But since this is such a complex topic, let's start with a brief review of microevolution. Remember that microevolution is any change in gene frequency from one generation to the next. And we saw a number of processes that can cause genetic change. You can get what's called a founder effect, where you have a population of individuals that may have in the population two different alleles, but in going through a bottleneck, just a few of those individual alleles are going to make it to the next generation, and they may not be representative of the population as a whole. So we then get a shift in gene frequency just by random chance. So this kind of genetic bottleneck and founder effect we saw as an example with the extra fingers that are more common in the children of the Amish. We can also get genetic changes by gene flow. So we may have one population that's genetically fairly homogeneous. Everybody has pretty much the same allele, but then individuals from another population move in, bringing in novelty to the population. So we then have a change in gene frequency by gene flow. And there's actually been a very clear example of that in the human population here in the US. If we think just about people of European descent, in 1790, most Americans were descended from the English, and there were some other Brits here, some Irish and some Scots, and a fair number of Germans, okay? But by the beginning of the year 2000, the composition of the children being born in the U.S. is very different. So over half of American children born in the year 2000 were actually had an ancestry from Latin America. So that's a mixture of Native American and Spanish. And so then we have all the Europeans here are now less than a quarter. So that's terrific change due to gene flow within our own population. We also get genetic change by mutation, and ultimately this is a source of all new forms of genetic material. So you may have a population that only has two alleles at a particular locus, but one individual out of that population, there's a mistake during DNA replication, so there's a novel mutation. So now we have a new mutation. And remember that even though mutation rates are very low at any given locus, we have billions of base pairs. And so we therefore find that each person has on average one or two mutant alleles not present in either parent. So there's constant change and constant movement of genetic material within any population because of mutation. Okay, then we see that we can have non-random mating, and this can have a big effect on gene frequency. First is assortative mating. So if we have these two birds that have particular genotype and they prefer to mate with other individuals of their own genotype, then their alleles will become more common in the population in subsequent generations. So we saw that actually with the snails. Left-handed snails can only mate with other left-handed snails. Right-handed snails can only mate with other right-handed snails. So these populations will actually eventually differentiate because they can only mate within suitable context. The most important source of microevolutionary change, however, clearly is natural selection. So if we have a population where essentially everybody has the same genotype, but we have a rare mutation or a rare allele that may have persisted from previous times, and it then becomes favored, then the gene will become much more common. That allele frequency will increase through time. So this is microevolution. This is the meat of real evolution here, where we have certain traits that confer an advantage because they're genetically programmed to produce, say, larger beaks in the case of Darwin's finches during the drought. The alleles for those larger beaks become more and more common in subsequent generations. So we saw that also with the example of Biston betularia, which is the speckled moth, where we have the typical genotype is to have two alleles that cause this white coloration and very occasional speckles, so it mixes in and it can be hidden the background of the lichens on the trees. But then there's a mutation, a dominant one, that causes melanism, that is to be black. And this black form is now is very hard to see. It's camouflaged against the polluted background of a sooty tree trunk or side of a tree, of a building. So here we have this allele that appears in the population, and there's tremendous selection pressure because predators will not be eating the individuals that possess that favorable allele. And so industrial melanism became very, very common in England by the end of the 19th century. Now, this is the sort of thing that's happening all the time, and the evidence for natural selection being a powerful force in evolution is really universal. We think of some pollutants as things that these are uncontrolled in the environment. These are not pesticides. These are not things that, you know, we're using to try to control bacteria. They're a byproduct of our industrial products that when we burn them, we get nasty, nasty poisons. So PCBs is a classic case of this, and this can cause a lot of cancer. Now, in areas where people live too close to garbage dumps or incinerators, for many years, there has been a concern that people would be exposed to high levels of these poisons, okay? Now, for PCB to hurt our health, it has to be able to bind onto a protein encoded by a gene that's called AHR2. Okay, that's the way the poison actually gets into our body and causes destruction to our health, okay? Now, in environments that have been heavily polluted, there are organisms now, like this fish, living in streams that's been exposed for decades to high levels of PCBs, that now carry a mutation of the AHR2 allele that renders them immune to PCBs. So we've seen in the case of deliberate poisoning of mosquitoes to try to control malaria, deliberate poisoning of weeds to try to improve crop production, that selection eventually leads to resistance to those pesticides. Here's a case where an unwanted poison is very common in the environment. And here, again, animals are evolving and they're becoming immune to it. And this is natural selection in action, favoring particular alleles that confer resistance to this nasty toxin. Now, when it comes to natural selection, this is the predominant force in microevolutionary change. We'll see many, many examples as we go along, beyond the Darwin's finches, the speckled moths, and that fish in the last example. Natural selection is happening everywhere all the time. It's so common that it's very important for geneticists to try to estimate which genes are under the heaviest selection that's causing the microevolutionary changes in living populations. To do this, we want to be able to measure the force of selection. So let's take a single locus trait. We have two alternative alleles. This is a classic Mendelian trait. Okay, so we have a genotype that can be homozygous for the dominant allele, a heterozygote, or homozygous for the recessive allele. Okay, what we want to then do is to follow individuals of known genotypes through their lifetime and simply count up how many babies they have that grow up and become breeding members of the next generation. Okay, so we want to find out how many surviving offspring individuals that have homozygote capital A compared to the number of surviving offspring for the other genotypes. And if we collect this data, we can actually estimate the strength of selection. So in this particular example, the homozygote dominant, on average, any individual in the population has on average 3 surviving offspring if they have that genotype. The heterozygotes likewise have 3, but the homozygote recessives only have 2. Okay? Now that may not seem like much of a difference, but if we calculate that into what is going into the next generation, for every 1 offspring that's being produced by this homozygote or this heterozygote, these are only producing 2/3 as many, okay? And that's quite a big difference if you keep doing this generation after generation after generation. So we first want to calculate the relative fitness, which is simply to divide the number of observed number of offspring divided by the most successful. So the most successful is to get 3. So 3 divided by 3 is 1, so they got a relative fitness of 1 or 100%. Likewise, a heterozygote. But the homozygote recessive is only has 2/3 the reproductive success on average. And so the difference between 1 and 2/3 is 1/3. That's the selection coefficient. So it literally means there's 1/3 more of these genotypes being represented in each successive generation than in the other. So this will lead to a very rapid spread of the capital A allele. When I showed the example last time of Bistian betularia, this graph estimated what would have happened if there was indeed a single melanic allele that was dominant, that to get this rapid of a change, and this pretty much mimics what was observed, going from virtually no black moths, whereas almost everybody had the speckled phenotype, to suddenly only within 40 years, almost everybody now having that melanistic form, the selection coefficient must have been about 0.5 or about 50%. What that means is that these individuals were twice as likely to have surviving offspring as any one of these. So that's a really, really big advantage.